Known for their hits like Runnin' and Passin' Me By, the Pharcyde were an oddity within the 90s rap scene, and I mean that in the best way possible. While they had their fair share of success and still have millions of monthly listeners on streaming, I don't hear many people talk about them as much as other groups from that era. But what if I told you that they recorded one of the most groundbreaking records in rap history that paved the way for countless rappers and producers down the road? Hi, I'm Bazz from Bazz Reviews, and this is the best place to discover cool music. So before we begin, let's talk a little bit about these guys. The Pharcyde's four members often said their rags-to-riches story was altered by the fact that they were from South Central Los Angeles. In a 1993 LA Times interview, it was revealed that Trey Hartson, better known as Slim Kid 3, was the only member from the area. Hartson met Compton's Amandu Wilcox, going by Imani, and Ramier Robinson, also known as Booty Brown, in high school. During that time, the three were in a dance group called 2 for 2, and they had performed in music videos for rappers like Tone Loc and Candyman, as well as in the television show In Living Color. They met the group's other members, Derek Fatlip Stewart and producer John J. Swift Martinez, through another after-school performing arts program hosted by a music teacher named Reggie Andrews. It was he who oversaw the group's very early writing sessions and helped teach the group about the ins and outs of the music industry. In early 1991, the group found additional management from another South Central auteur, John Singleton of Boys in the Hood fame. Around that same time, the group recorded their first demo tape and sent it to various labels. They struck gold when Mike Ross of Delicious Vinyl Records dug the tape and gave them a chance to record their aforementioned debut album, Bizarre Ride 2. At the time, I don't think anyone was expecting it to become what it did, so let's rewind back to 1992, where I'll give you an inside view on each of the 11 full-length tracks and why they're influential in hip-hop today. We'll start things off with Oh Shit, and from the jazzy piano sample of Donald Byrd driving the song along, or the goofy penmanship of each of the members, this might be one of my favorite opening tracks on any rap album in history. I really don't have many crazy words for this one, other than the fact that it absolutely slaps and keeps you engaged from start to finish. As Fatlip said in the final verse, I guess that's one of those things that makes you go shit. After a few skits, we turn to For Better or For Worse, and I think this might be my least favorite track on the album. To be fair, the beat on here is pretty decent, but I feel like the overall layering and mix of the song can be a bit harsh at times. I like how most of the album has a minimalist feel, but this really lost my attention after the 3-minute mark. The last 2 minutes with people ad-libbing in one channel and a woman talking in the other are completely superfluous. Plus, as a whole, For Better or For Worse had a bit of a drop-off in overall quality on the lyrical side of things. Don't worry, because I'm the type of name redacted is up next. And this has one of the album's smoothest beats, in my opinion. It feels like a callback to late 80s rap pioneers Eric B. and Rakim, with a sharp Pharcyde twist. The farther you get into this track, the crazier the verses get, in my opinion. I think that Imani and Fatlip both do quite well, but I'd say Booty's verse is easily the funniest and hardest the track has to offer. I also want to give a nod to guest star Buckwheat of another 90s hip-hop group, The Wascals, who also gives a pretty solid appearance on the song. Next up, we've got Soulflower. Each guy is throwing down goofy insults at each other on the mic for 4.5 minutes, and that's not something I'd expect from most rappers. Their insults would usually be directed at someone or something more specific, but again, this is the Pharcyde we're talking about. In terms of the overall album, Soulflower is one of the better offerings. When I got done listening to this track for the first time, I couldn't help but feel like Pete Rock took influence for the beat on a war tour with the synth hook on here. So you could put in an argument for this being a pretty important song for another reason too. Switching gears to the confessional that is On the DL, it showcases things the group has done in their past that they want to keep under wraps, but wrote a song about them, I guess? Seems counterintuitive, but in my books, it's an interesting track covering topics such as murder, having sex, and being a poser. I wasn't a big fan of the darker lyrics they chose to work with on here, as it didn't really work together with their overall style. I did love the beat on here though. It feels like something J Dilla would have put together on a Slum Village beat like Fall in Love or Selfish, ironically enough. So I guess there's another future influence we can check off our list. And now we've got Officer. And while we've seen relatively humorous, lighthearted musical moments across the record up until this point, the group took another left turn with this one. I think this is one of the less enjoyable beats personally, but you really have to listen closely to the lyrical content. The guys talk about their distaste with the police, talking about possibly getting pulled over for having expired license plate tags, or merely standing on a street corner talking to women. Hell, even the sheer sight of getting followed by one puts them into a frenzy, with the chorus of, "Please, don't pull me over, Mr. Officer, don't pull me over, Mr. Officer, please," resonating with me the most. Officer feels much more real and genuine than the previous track did. In a time when the LAPD was under heavy scrutiny for the events in mid-1992, this song is an interesting reflection of the society that once, and still exists today. Officer still holds up rather well in its tales of racial profiling, and could serve as a unique anthem for the social justice movements that have taken place over the last year and change. Back to the lighter side of things now, we've got Yamama, and in Rolling Stone's review of Bizarre Ride 2, they called this song their favorite on the album, and I have to say, their appraisal is pretty spot on. When I first listened to this song, I was fondly reminded of that Yo Mama YouTuber from when I was younger. I think I was the funniest, edgiest kid in school by watching those compilations for hours and hours. Like Soulflower, you've got those classic schoolyard insults, but as you can only deduce, in the form of Yo Mama jokes. This is the Pharcyde at their funniest, and the Yo Mama guy has nothing on some of the roasts they pull out. I mean, seriously, who thinks of this shit? This is probably the Pharcyde track that most people will know from the album, and it's passing me by. It topped the Billboard Rap Singles chart and hit number 52 on the Hot 100. The song depicts each of the members getting passed up by potential love interests, hence the name. The production here is phenomenal and includes multiple samples that range from Quincy Jones and Jimi Hendrix of all people. The lyrics are equally as great too, but what I thought was the craziest thing of all was T.I. name-dropping this song in blurred lines. It's just another one of those many examples we've seen thus far of the wide influence the Pharcyde has had on hip-hop and modern music as a whole. So now I want to take a bit of a break from the action here to talk about some of the reasons why the Pharcyde might not be as immediately appreciated as other groups from the 90s. The drama. While J. Swift showed himself to be an immensely talented producer over the course of this record, he believed he was not properly given the credit he deserved. The other members would say they produced his beats, which he rightfully objected to. Other Fish was the only song on the record that was not produced by him, and the change of hands can really be felt here. The production was handled by Slim Kid and another local producer, L.A.J. The use of slower, hazier samples and drums are a cool shift from what we've heard up until this point. It makes for one of the most impactful moments on the record, and arguably one of the strongest on the B-side. Lyrically, the track is a spiritual successor to Passin' Me By, the title and chorus being a callback to the classic phrase, "There's plenty of other fish in the sea." You know, if I had a dollar for every time a woman told me that, I'd have a lot of dollars. Switching gears here, we now have Pack the Pipe. It's about the guys getting high and features zany vocals along with one of the best beats on the album, with a cool jazz sample from the legendary John Coltrane and Johnny Hartman leading the way. The spacey vocals the guys go for here takes you on the trip with them, for better or for worse. See what I did there? Not only that, but they let their drug dealer, Quentin, have a guest spot on the album. Please name me another rap group that has the fucking audacity to do that. How they got away with this one, I have no idea, but I guess it does parallel the theme of getting high, so why don't we call it world building and leave it at that. And now we're at the final full-length cut of the record, Return of the B-Boy. And unfortunately, it was missing a legitimate spark to keep me engaged from start to finish. The synths and the bass lines they use sound like cheesy end credit music from a 90s sitcom, a decent stylistic choice for what it's worth, but it misses much more in its vocal punch. The middle portion of the song with Imani and Booty on the mic is definitely far weaker than the bookends. If there's anything positive to take away, at least we can identify some possible influences for future acts. Personally, I could have seen this as leaving an impact on a group like Gangstar with its production and lyrical flows. Now that we're finally through an official track-by-track review, I think it's important to look at this record holistically. When West Coast hip-hop was defined by wonky synths and songs about gang life, the Pharcyde presented an alternative yet refreshing take on hip-hop music. J. Swift was a legend on the production side, going against the G-Funk norms by substituting the heavy-hitting synths and guitars for the jazzy samples that would be an East Coast rapper's wet dream to rap on. I think that's really what makes Bizarre Ride 2 so special to me. As an East Coast hip-hop fan, I felt like this is in the same ranks as some of the best in the genre, like The Low End Theory, 36 Chambers, and Ready to Die, albeit without the grim and lyrical storytelling. Getting high, being rejected by girls, and receiving or doling out insults from your friends are all part of young adult life as we know it. I hope that you guys can sit down with your headphones to say, "Yep, this happened to me. I know how it feels." There are so many memorable and creative songs and stories told in just 56 minutes, and it's been so influential to a lot of producers and rappers that came after them. Whether it's J. Dilla, Gangstar, Pete Rock, or a figure as big as Kanye West, who called this album his favorite of all time in 2010, Bizarre Ride 2 should be getting a lot more credit for what it accomplished. In the 2005 edition of 1001 Albums You Must Hear Before You Die, Robert Dimmery sums it up all much better than I could have. Quote, "When many MCs and rappers were striving to keep it real, the Pharcyde went out of their way to keep it original. J. Swift's production, along with the core members, sacrificed the more immediately catchy hooks for greater depth and a lush, soulful sound. While this may have cost them the audiences at the time, the album is now a true classic, both of its time and of hip-hop. As the record fast approaches its 30th birthday, I hope that you all take the time to check out this diamond in the rough." Well, that, and how cool would you be if you listened to an album with a vagina disguised as a roller coaster on the cover?